My most sincere gratitude to everybody in this room who's had the courage to come together with a common goal in a fight for the common good. We face immense challenges, as this presentation or this event has clearly shown. We have challenges from every direction, too many to fully comprehend. But there's a challenge that we face that the vast majority of society is still unaware of, a challenge that's been going on for 6.5 decades in plain sight, a challenge that official agencies and experts have lied to us about. My name is Dane Wigington. I'm the lead researcher and administration for a website called geoengineeringwatch.org. The purpose of our site, the only purpose of our site, is to sound the alarm on global climate engineering. We're non-political. We don't sell anything. I'm not a professional speaker. I'm a father. And that fact caused me to put my life on hold 10 years ago when I became aware of this issue. I have a background with Bechtel Power Corporation, going back a long way, but I have a background in renewable energy. I live in the wilderness of Northern California. I'm completely off-grid. I have wind, solar, and hydropower. But that, when I moved to this location, surrounded by wilderness, and began to lose 50, 60, sometimes 70 and 80% of my solar power uptake, clearly something was going on in our skies, as you see from this time-lapse video. And by the way, these pictures are from all over the globe, from people who are part of our fight. I began to research this issue because clearly something was going on, something radical. When I found the mountain of data about geoengineering, climate engineering, I was astounded. I hadn't heard of this issue before, especially with my background. I found the primary elements in these patents that Billy named. There's about 150 patents. We have the list of most of those patents on our website. Aluminum bearing being primary elements in these patents. I began to test precipitation. I didn't want to find what I found. I'd hoped this perhaps maybe wasn't what it appeared to be, but I did find aluminum in my first rain test, and during the subsequent several years, I had lab tests go from 7 parts per billion of aluminum, which is already high given my filtered forested location, to as much as 3,450 parts per billion of aluminum in a single rain event. This is highly toxic rain. The point of this presentation tonight is to sound the alarm. Much more technical data is available on our website, geoengineeringwatch.org. And after this presentation, I have about 700 commercial DVD copies with 5 presentations on those DVDs, and I will give them away to anyone who will put those DVDs to use. If you choose to support our cause, anything you give will go directly back into the supplying of DVDs and flyers to activists around the country. But I'll give DVDs to anybody and everybody in this room as long as that supply holds out. We're on the fourth floor in the rotational speaker booth.
Thank you, Dave.
Thank you. Thank you, Michael.
Thank you, Dave.
Why this fight? Why does this fight matter so much? This is the hole in the bottom of the boat. Again, in spite of all the challenges we face, if we don't deal with this challenge, nothing else will matter. This is not a fight I wanted. As I stated, I'm not an activist. I'm not a politically oriented person. But climate engineering is decimating the entire web of life, from the clouds to the ground, quite literally. The overall effects of climate engineering are so profound that all of us are part of a grand and lethal experiment without our knowledge or consent. The entire web of life is a part of this experiment. The ramifications are so utterly profound that if we stay on this course, we face short-term extinction, not just the human race, but life on Earth. That's how profound our situation is. And we've been told that these are condensation trails. But in fact, that is a lie of immense proportion. We were also told that some couches and chairs burning on the first floor of Building 7 at 9/11 caused that 50-story steel structure high-rise to fall. So much of our society is living in a delusion that if we can't look up and see that what's happening in our skies, it looks like we're living in another planet, literally. In regard to what's a condensation trail and what is not, all commercial aircraft and all military tankers have a high bypass turbofan jet engine. We have a tutorial for this jet engine on our homepage of Geoengineering Watch, and you can learn about this engine. It's basically a jet-powered fan. 85% of the air that passes through this engine is non-combustion. This engine is by design nearly incapable of making a condensation trail except under the most extreme circumstances. So why are we seeing what we see in our sky? Because this is not condensation. If you walk down the street on a cold day, somewhere where it's cold, certainly not very cold here, but if you walk down the street on a cold day and your breath condenses, do you turn around after you walk a mile and see a cloud hanging behind you? This is not condensation. The stated goal of climate engineering, again, everybody wants to know why, and there's a lot of answers to that question. A lot of people want to put climate engineering in this box or that box, but it's not just this or that, it's this and that and many other things. Climate modification has been going on a large scale since at least the late 40s. We have enough historical documentation to prove that. There are many aspects to geoengineering. And again, for those that don't know exactly what it is, it's the manipulation of Earth's weather systems. That's the stated purpose. Why would they do this? The primary stated goal is solar radiation management. And in regard to this issue, it's imperative. If you want to share this issue with others and you want to have credibility, use the science terms. Stay away from the chemtrails terms. It's not a scientific term. If you use solar radiation management, climate engineering, geoengineering, stratospheric aerosol geoengineering, there's a number of terms, but even just climate engineering is good enough. People can go search online and they'll find science instead of conspiracy theory and hoax. In regard to climate engineering, again, the intentional manipulation of Earth's climate systems. Why would they manipulate these systems? Again, solar radiation management, the primary stated purpose is to block some of the sun's incoming thermal radiation. It's created what's called global dimming. We know now from science study that 20-25% of the sun's direct rays no longer reach the surface of the planet. That's how much direct sunlight is being eliminated. We know we have weather warfare going on around the globe, and any form of climate modification is weather warfare. And any form of climate modification is also biological warfare. Whatever they put up there comes down on us, and we're breathing it, and we know we're breathing it, and there's no speculation. This is not theory. We have lab tests from around the globe to prove this fact. So when we have these kind of programs going on, for the length of time they've been going on, the effects start to become catastrophic. Along with these programs, the saturation of the atmosphere with conductive, toxic, metallic particulates. There are other elements to climate engineering that work in conjunction with that to manipulate those particulates. Most of you have probably heard of HARP, High Frequency Active Auroral Research Program. HARP is an ionosphere heater. If you think your cell phones are dangerous, the ionosphere heaters are much more dangerous. There's at least 2 to 3 dozen of these large ground-based facilities around the globe. Some of them can transmit 3.5 billion watts of power into the atmosphere. Available data indicates that they can heat the atmosphere to 15,000 degrees Fahrenheit or more, the ionosphere. Why would they do this? Back to how are they modifying the weather? So that causes changes in pressure. They can manipulate the jet stream. And now we live in a scenario where so much weather modification is going on that literally we are at the point now where we have no natural weather. When you taint any part of the system, you taint the entire system. And the fallout, again, from these programs is so immense that those in power will do anything they can to hide this for as long as they can, for obvious reasons. We have collaboration between global governments. We know this collaboration is going on. In fact, when they have climate meetings, like we've had in Cancun and Copenhagen, we've noted aluminum futures increasing 25-30% after these meetings. They're not talking about cutting carbon. They're making backroom deals to ramp up climate engineering even more. And these systems can only harm the planet. Just like a pharmaceutical treatment, as this been talked about during this whole event. Take this for that, and by the way, here's 20 things that will happen if you do. The planet's no different. So the downstream effect right now is absolutely horrific. Who would do this? It's a question many people want to know. All roads lead back to those who print the money. those who start the wars, those who can fund anything they want. And we know that since 1993, the Pentagon can't account for $8.5 trillion. How do you lose $8.5 trillion? And that's simply what we know about. So those in power, again, can fund anything they want. All roads lead back to the central bankers. That's who controls the military. Our goal, our hope, is to spread awareness enough where our brothers and sisters in the military, who are there for the right reasons, the vast majority of them, that we would raise critical mass of awareness to the point where they know and where they refuse to participate. How long has this been going on? Again, since the late 40s. That's a long time to manipulate the weather. Most of us here in this room have never experienced truly natural weather, and the weather system is much more malleable than people have been led to believe. They've been led to believe you can't control the weather, you can't harm the weather, you can't alter the weather. This is an absolute lie. In regard to the drought in California, we know this is a 2+2=4 equation. We know the drought in California is a direct result of climate engineering. We have satellite imagery of blankets spraying off our coast that disrupts the hydrological cycle, disrupts the rain cycle. This data has been given, by the way, to officials in Sacramento. I was in Sacramento 2 days ago, and finally told by the staff of one of the representatives that they all know this is going on, they don't know what to do. I've been told to my face by a NOAA scientist off the record, they all know what's going on. They're alarmed as hell. That was her words, not mine. Again, they don't know what to do. But when they have enough cover, when enough of the population recognizes this is going on, they'll come from every corner. There's no question about that. We just have to raise awareness to the point where they can. So at this point, we're living literally on a highly, highly toxic planet. And that comes from a lot of directions, I realize. We all recognize the chemicals we're exposed to, the other forms of industrialized pollution. We have the vaccinations, the food, and so forth. We have Fukushima. But now we have something that is so total that you can't hide anywhere from this. There is nowhere to hide on our planet. We know this from a study from 1,000 whales from 2010, taken from the most remote places on the planet. And the report stated, and I quote, the whales had jaw-dropping levels of aluminum in their tissue. You can't hide from this material. Every human test subject that we know of that's been tested for the primary metals in these patents is off the chart. Hair, blood, and urine tests. Again, the lab tests prove what's coming down in our rain. If it's in our rain, it's in our air. It's in our air, it's in our lungs. We have internationally recognized neuroscientists like Dr. Russell Blaylock, who has stated on the record, he has a great courage. Dr. Russell Blaylock, great courage. These particles are so small, we're talking about nanoparticles, that you can't filter out with any conventional mask. They enter through the lung lining, go straight into the bloodstream where they adhere to cell receptors like a plaque. How long can we go on like this? So, again, although we face challenges like Fukushima and vaccinations, resource depletion, and so forth, if we're breathing all this stuff with every breath we take, if we can't walk outside without sucking in a lung full of heavy metal, how long will we be thinking clearly enough to face any challenge? How long? Again, I didn't want this battle. This is the last thing I imagine taking 10 years of my life off to do. But how can one turn away from this once we know what's going on? We have other players in this cabal of insanity. Monsanto, what a surprise. So while they're contaminating the entire planet with toxic heavy metals, and we know that they are, we know there's so much metal coming down on us that it's changing soil pH values. That takes a lot of metal. And the forest where I live was thriving only 10 years ago. It's virtually silent now. Soil pH values in Northern California have changed 10 to 12 times toward alkaline. That takes a tremendous amount of metal. The entire forest is dying right now. We are seeing aquatic and terrestrial insect life decline, as measured by Forest Service biologists whom I work with. 90% decline in 10 years. If the bugs can't make it, how long will we make it? Tree decline around the globe. This is a virtual crash, by the way. Tree decline around the globe is absolutely cataclysmic. 30% of the boreal forest in Alaska is dead. Drive around here and look at your trees. They look terrible. And one other consequence of climate engineering, by the way, disrupts The hydrological cycle, contaminating the entire planet, every breath we take, it's also shredding the ozone layer. It's decimating the ozone layer. I'm sure most of you, if you've even been out in the sun to any length of time, you've noticed the sun is burning the hell out of you. It's not your imagination. We're actually metering UV radiation. We're told by all major agencies that no more than 95%, or rather 95% of all incoming UV should be UVA. Only 5%, no more, should be UVB. We're seeing 60% UVB. That means we're getting something like 1,000% more UVB than we're being told. It's burning the bark off of trees. It's killing plankton, by the way. That intense UV, this is the downstream effects. This is what happens when you try to exercise power and control, which is ultimately what these programs are about. It's what the central bankers are about, power and control. When you exercise this kind of power and control over Earth's life support system for 65 years, very, very bad things happen. So what the UVB is killing plankton. Plankton is 50% of Earth's oxygen supply. 50 to 60% of Earth's plankton's populations are now dead. Ecosystems are crashing around the globe. 90% of global pelagic fish populations are dead. Yes, Fukushima is a problem. Many of you have probably seen the fish die-offs, the seals dying, and so forth. There's a lot of issues in the ocean. But when we have the climate engineering killing the base to the food chain, when we have oceans that are warming rapidly, and by the way, the stated purpose of this, again, to slow a runaway climate change event by solar radiation management, we have enough data to know this is making a bad situation far worse overall. Why would that be a surprise? So as the oceans warm, they release methane, frozen methane on the seafloor. I encourage everybody to not believe anything I say and search, please search Arctic methane emergency. We're seeing methane releases in a lot of places around the globe. When methane releases in entirety, many of you have heard of the Bermuda Triangle, the ship sinkings, this is methane release. Methane releases from the seafloor, it aerates the water like a bottle of champagne. Ships sink, they have no buoyancy. So this has been happening for a long time, but now it's happening on such a scale that when large releases happen, it deoxygenates the water, creates hypoxic and anoxic zones. So that's the likely primary cause of the fish die-offs everywhere. And as that methane release, it feeds as a positive feedback loop. Methane goes into the atmosphere. Methane over a 10-year time horizon is 100 times more potent than CO2 as a greenhouse gas. So the system starts to feed on itself. And climate engineering has helped this to happen. It shouldn't be a surprise. They've changed upper-level wind currents. That changes ocean currents. We have warm water pumping straight into the Arctic now, helping to release methane. There's enough methane in the Arctic to cause a Permian-style mass extinction 100 times over. Nothing like this has ever happened before at this speed on planet Earth. Paleo data makes that clear. Global extinction figures today. We are losing 200 plus species of plant and animal a day to extinction. And a lot of people will try to argue that this is natural to have species coming and going. That's 10,000 times background extinction rates, 10,000 times. Nothing normal about that. That's 1,000,000% of normal. The atmosphere is as thin as a layer of paint on a basketball. That's what allows us to live on this planet. That's what allows us to survive. When you experiment with that thin layer of atmosphere, that's extreme folly, and that's exactly what's happening. And we're all part of that grand and lethal experiment. Now, many would wonder, why aren't we being told about this? Why aren't officials telling us about this kind of program? Isn't that their job? No, their job is to hide this. Why did the state of California stop testing for water quality in 2002? Why is that? I've been in high-level EPA meetings in Sacramento, one arranged by a congressional rep, five top EPA officials told in my face that the system is rigged, that they are told to test for combustion particulates only. The rest of their samples go out the window. You can't find what you're told not to look for. That's how the system's designed, just like when Fukushima happened, and suddenly the safe level of radiation goes up 10,000%. They move any figure around any way they want. In fact, a friend of mine with Union of Concerned Scientists in Northern California has measured the temperature deviation from the official reading to the actual reading, 4.6 degree discrepancy, underreporting, not overreporting like a lot of people want to think, underreporting, which means the planet is much, much warmer than we've been told. And climate engineering, again, is making this worse, not better, but they are going to continue to double down until people are in the streets with their pitchforks and torches, realizing that we are literally, quite literally, in a fight for our life. So don't expect the agencies to do anything. I've been in Lieutenant Governor Newsom's office, presented data to his aide and himself. There's no question they know this is going on. They're not going to do a thing. I've been in Barbara Boxer's office. I've spoken in front of the California Air Resources Board. Climate scientists. Also, total denial, criminal denial, I would argue. Criminal denial. I was 2 weeks ago with internationally recognized climate scientist Guy McPherson and tried to confront that denial. You cannot have a legitimate discussion about climate change unless you discuss climate engineering first and foremost. You can't eliminate the biggest part of the puzzle of all. So this is where these people have to be held accountable, whether they're meteorologists, whoever they are. And on that note, Raytheon, one of the largest weather modification players, does all the weather modeling for the National Weather Service and NOAA. You have the foxes quite literally running the henhouse. That's the world we live in. Lockheed Martin does all the modeling for the FAA. So again, we have those that are running the weather mod doing the modeling. We also have a lot of disaster capitalists on this. As I mentioned, Monsanto, we have weather trading derivatives going on. So while they're trying to hide the full scope of damage with climate engineering by doing even more damage at the same time from the same programs, they're also running gaming casinos on the stock market for weather trading derivatives. So they decide whose crops fail, whose don't. They decide who gets rain, who doesn't. They decide how toxic that rain is. Nobody has a right to experiment on us in this manner. And the media's betrayal is astounding, absolutely astounding. The things people will do for a paycheck and a pension is absolutely inexcusable. It's inexcusable, and it's up to us to hold them accountable. Every single one of us in this room. This can't be done by one or two. We're under no less than a direct assault. Again, if you can't walk outside without living underneath this, and everything they put up is coming down, and this is beyond any dispute. We have film footage of this happening again. Military tankers, all this is available on our site. If we're facing for a fight for life, again, defending our children and trying to provide them some sort of future is not an option. It's an obligation. We have to engage in this fight. If we truly pretend to love them or profess to love them, we have to engage in this fight. And silence is betrayal, as Martin Luther King said. There comes a time when silence is betrayal. And for those that don't want to address this issue because of the resistance they may get from friends, I encourage you, please, please come out of the shadows. Please help us address this issue. Educate yourself, no fear. When you introduce to people, don't do it with trepidation. Be confident that what you're doing is based on solid science, because it is. Now is when we find out again what we're made of. We need to ask ourselves how long we can hold our breath. As Billy correctly stated, every breath we take is laden with this material. This is an extremely critical hour, and the power structure's done a lot to try to condition all of us for this. They put this in kids' films. I don't know if you know that. You can see that on some of our data. They put these trails in children's film to try to condition them and so forth. But no matter how difficult this challenge looks, and you hear a lot of people say that, they say, what can I do? What can I do? It's hopeless. I can't do anything. That is absolutely untrue. If your child was in a burning house, and you know there was very little chance that you could save them, would you not try? Of course. Would you not try? And if we know we have something that we can do, because we are right now on the fast track for a planet that won't support life. If we stay on this track, that's where we'll end up. But if you knew there was something you could do that could radically affect the equation for the better, a positive leap in the right direction, would you not do that? Wouldn't you do that? If your child was in that burning house, would you not go in no matter what? Come on. I'm asking this, and I'll leave with this. I'm asking everybody in this room to help me move forward with the attempt to bring this issue to light once and for all, to stop the climate engineering insanity once and for all. Please help me in this endeavor. I need every one of you. Thank you.